Okay, as I said, last lecture was about interaction of light charged particles, and we discussed ionization, and we obtained this Bethe-Bloch formula, which describes this ionization. And also we discussed another type of interactions. If you remember, it was also this Bremsstrahlung radiation and production of this Bremsstrahlung photons. Also, it was Cherenkov radiation, which is produced by light particle, which is moving through material with velocity, which is higher than velocity of the light in this material. And also, we discussed transition radiation, if you remember, and all these processes is in principle possible to use for detection of particles, this light charged particles. Okay, and it's for us, it is necessary to know also how to detect these particles, but also how is possible to obtain information about energies. And because these energies are in a very wide range, yeah, it's there are also necessity to use different type of detectors, yeah. And these different ranges of energy, it's given because we have different sources of electrons. For example, if we have these electrons for atomic cloak and also in molecules, we will obtain very, very small energies, because this binding energies of electrons, this outside electrons, for example, these valence electrons, they are relatively very, very small. It is in the range of electron volts, and maybe up to kVs. Second possibility, it is electrons which are produced by some processes which are in this inner parts of this atomic cloud, and these inner electrons which have a much higher binding energies. It is possible to be for lead, uranium, and very heavy atoms to have even binding energies for these electrons which are on K shell, they are about 90 kV. That means we need to have a spectrometer which is working in the range from electron volts up to 100 kVs. Okay, that we have also this electrons which are produced by beta decay. That means now we are going really to processes which are connected with nuclear world, that there are these processes in the nucleus of atoms. And in this case, we have this beta radioactivity and production of electrons, which are within the range of kVs up to MeVs, yeah? That in this case, there are also, if you remember, we have also some possibility of conversion electrons, which are produced by these nuclear processes, but in these processes, this energy is transferred by this electromagnetic field to electron, and the electron is running out of atom. Yeah, and okay, in this case, these energies are the same as or near to energies which have gamma, which is produced by the excitation of nucleus. No, and it is also possible to obtain electron, and in this case also positrons, in pair production. You remember, we already discussed these three processes in which this gamma is converted from inside material two electrons. This energy from gamma is transferred to electrons, and you have three processes. One is photo effect, second is Compton scattering, and third is this pair production. And during this pair production, electron and positron pairs is produced. In this case, this electron and positron pair energy depends really on gamma energies, and if we will have energy of gamma which is in the range of MeVs up to GeVs, it will be really also this electron and positron will have this. But it is possible to have also particles which are decaying by electron positron pairs, and we will have also this electron positron pairs. And if you want to study such particles, you need to have spectrometers which are working in the range of energy of electrons and positrons higher than MeVs and up to, for example, tens or hundreds of GeVs. This hundreds GeVs, it's approximately situation which is for this LHC experiment, this high energy experiments, which are, for example, in the CERN. Okay, this detectors is possible to use as detector of electrons and also for determination of energy. That means also in principle as spectrometer. Also, it's possible to have a combination of magnetic and electric fields and to obtain this energy from movement of this particle in magnetic or electric field. Yeah? And detector will use for detection of this particle and say, okay, this is electron, but energy will be obtained from this movement in magnetic and electric field. Okay, that now have a look on this type of detectors or spectrometers. At first, we will discuss these gas detectors, yeah, how it is work, and also I will show you this different type of gas detectors. Second possibility, there are channeltrons. These channeltrons are usually for low energy electrons. You will see that it is in the range of these kVs and from some electron volts to kVs. Third possibility, there are semiconductor detectors. Semiconductor detectors we already discussed during this discussion of this gamma detectors, and the semiconductor detectors is possible to use for detection of gamma. From this reason, it is clear that it is possible to use also for detection of electrons, light charged particles, because also this detection of gamma is working in this way, that this gamma is interacting by this photo effect, Compton scattering, pair production, and this detector, semiconductor detector, detects this electron, which is or positrons, which are produced by these three processes. Okay, that now this we will look on spectrometers. One possibility is the electrostatic spectrometers which use electrostatic field, and if field is high, only electrons which have higher energy than some threshold will go through this electric field. Yeah? And change of voltage will produce the different threshold, and it will be possible by this changing obtained whole spectrum. Second possibility, this possibility to use magnetic field, and you know that this movement inside this magnetic field is given by momenta of these electrons or positrons, and from radius of movement of these electrons inside this magnetic field, it's possible to obtain information about electron momenta, and from momenta it's possible to calculate energy. For high energy electrons, positrons, or also muons, it's possible to use the lepton spectrometers, in which we will discuss these gas detectors, and we have a proportional chamber, which is possible to use as track detectors of particle. And after tracking of path of particle and direction of movement of particle, we will put this particle to magnetic field with high magnetic field intensity. And after that, we will have again, for example, this proportional chamber, and we will again will make track. And this change of direction of this track is possible to use, and knowledge of this intensity of this magnetic field, it's possible to use for determination of momenta. This is very similar as for these magnetic spectrometers, but it will be no whole radius and detection of radius, but it will be some kick, some change of direction of movement. And it's also possible to use for detection this Cherenkov detectors, which use this Cherenkov radiation, which is radiation which is produced by particles which are moving through material with velocity which is higher than velocity of the light. Okay, first we will look on this gas field detectors. In this case, it is very high efficiency of this gas field detectors, and here we have high voltage, and here is current, yeah, produced amplitude, produced current. That means it is also named, this diagram is named as volt ampere characteristic. Yeah. That means if we will increase voltage here, it will be some increasing and of output or of current which will go in this detector. That means how this gas field detectors look like. This is some chamber with gas, and this gas is inside this electric field, which is produced by some voltage. And if particle is going through this gas, you have ionization, which is possible to calculate by this Bethe-Bloch formula. And this ionization will produce pairs of electron and ion. And because you have this high voltage, this is this some electrostatic field, these electrons are going to one cathode, and ion are going to second cathode, yeah, opposite. And we have different ranges in which these gas fields are working. Yeah, first range. Yeah, it is given that for very low voltage. In this case, this voltage is not enough to take these electrons and ion from the field in which you have this electron-ion pairs, that means this plasma, and you have recombination. For very high, for very low voltage, you have full recombination and not output signal. Yeah. For higher voltage, that some part of this electron ion pairs will not have recombination, and you will obtain some output signal. Yeah. Second part is part in which this recombination, you have enough voltage, enough high voltage, that this recombination, it is negligible. Yeah. That means all pairs of ion and electron are going to cathode and anode, yeah, ions and electrons, and you have the same output for all voltages in this range, yeah, and in this range this ionization chambers are working, this gas field detectors which are working in this part of this volt ampere current diagram are named as ionization chamber. It is without amplification, yeah, that means it is only this output which is produced by all these pairs of ion and electron. That means this output is relatively weak. Yeah. Second range is started in the for this voltage, for which these electrons, because you have higher voltage, that means this field is higher. That means also acceleration of these electrons and ions is higher. And for some of voltage, this acceleration, mainly for electrons, will be enough to start ionization of this electron. That means you will produce new electron-ion pairs. That means it is working in this way, that for higher and higher voltage, you have higher and higher velocity of these electrons and higher ionization and production of another pairs of electrons and ions. Yeah, that means in this case, this output is proportional to voltage. Yeah, and this is reason why these detectors are named as proportional detectors. Yeah, proportional detectors, proportional chambers. That they work in the range of proportionality. In this case, you have amplification because any electron ion pair will produce more and more pairs, and this number of these pairs will depend on voltage. Last part of this range, this fourth, it is in the Geiger-Miller region. Yeah. In this case, this ionization is very high, which is produced by acceleration and second ionization and by collisions and production new electron ion pairs. And in this range, for any ionization, discharge is starting. Yeah. And in this range, these detectors which are working in this range, they are named as Geiger-Miller counters. Yeah. These Geiger-Miller counters have very high amplification, and for any particle, for any energy of this particle, you will obtain this discharge and very high amplitude of this output signal. Yeah. That means it is around 1.6 volt, yeah. And what is disadvantage of these detectors? For proportional chambers, for ionization chambers, you will obtain output which is linearly dependent on energy of this particle, or energy which is deposited in detector by this particle. For Geiger-Miller counters, you will have no this connection between this energy of particle and output signal. For any particle with any energy, you will obtain for Geiger-Miller counter this the same output, which is given only by this discharge. Yeah. Okay. That means this is these detectors are widely used, and they later, for example, for present, we have also these semiconductor detectors. But for this in history, it was only these gas detectors. But in any case, for many. For many usage, for many applications, these gas field detectors are used now. It is possible to do not only as detector of energy and of one particle, but it is also possible to prepare this position sensitive detector or track detectors. Yeah. This is one is based on this proportional chamber. We have multi-wire, multi-electrode, and we have anode sensitive wires, which are placed between two cathode plates. And we have many of these wires, and they are placed in different directions. And that means that we have a few planes, and we see which wire was firing, and from this we see in which place was this ionization and this particle, which in which place is was particle movement. And if you have these wires which are in different directions, crossing of these wires show you in which place you have this particle going through this plane of this multi-wire proportional chamber. Second possibility, there are drift chambers. In this case, it's possible to use drift of charge from ionization to anode. And you have some typical drift velocities, and from this, which drift velocity is possible to obtain information about distance from timing. You will obtain information about distance. Last type of this gas field position sensitive detector, this is time projection chambers. In this case, you have cylinder, which is filled by gas, and end cap, which is based on this multi-wire chambers. And it is also possible, and from drift of this ions and electrons, it's possible to obtain information about z-axis. This multi-wire chambers will show you two coordinates, that means x and z, and this timing and this drift will show you which is z-axis distance coordinate. And it's possible to put this time projection chamber to homogeneous magnetic field. And in this case, we will obtain space information and space measurement and 3D measurements. And this is this positive position sensitive detectors, it's possible to use for detection and spectrometry of high energy electron and positron. Okay, it was high energy electron and positron. Now we are going to low energy electrons, and how is possible to detect this low energy electron. And for detection of them, it's possible to use detectors which are named as channeltron. Yeah. Okay, it's possible to use for energy range from about 10 of electron volts to 30 kV. Yeah. In this case, you have channel from glass and ceramics. This is here. Yeah. And you have semiconductor surface layer, which is inside. This is this. This is semiconductor surface layer. Here you have electrode, and this primary electron is running here. They will produce on this semiconductor surface layer new electrons, secondary electrons. And again, it will be also a scattering of this electron production of new electrons. And again, on this semiconductor surface layer, we will obtain new electrons. And okay, you have multiplying of these electrons. On the end, you have many of output electrons, and this this channel is from glass, yeah, glass with semiconductor surface layer inside. This amplification is up to 10 to the 7. Yeah, what is very useful and very important, that there are very small sensitivity to gamma detection. This is very big advantage, yeah, because very oftenly we use this detector of electrons in the field in which we have not only electrons but also photon. And it is important to have possibility to distinguish these two types of particles. Okay, that in this case they are very small. Yeah, this is this channels are very small, and they have radiuses around micrometers, tens of micrometers. Yeah? That means it's possible to use many, even millions of such channeltrons, and to obtain something which is named as channeltron plates, and it is also possible to use as tracking detectors. Yeah, and they work. There are some miniature electron amplifiers which are working independently. This amplification, as I said, it's possible to use, if we will use two in cascade, to go up to 10 to the 7, but okay, one is 10 to the 4. And this, as I said, this plate will have position sensitivity, and because distances between these channels are also in tenth of micrometers, you have such resolution, such space resolution. And what is also a big advantage, it is that there are very small sensitivity to magnetic field for these detectors. Okay, that that time of this detector is about 10 nanoseconds. That time is fine. And here is efficiency. Here is energy, and here is efficiency. It is in electron volts, and okay, this is from 10 up to from 10 electron volts up to 10 kV. Yeah, and you see that maximum is here. This is one of type of such detectors. That means that they are different for different types, but in any case, this is in the range of electron volts and kV, up to kV. Okay, third type of detectors, there are semiconductor detectors. Okay, this is very oftenly used, and this is mainly for detection of electrons and for electron spectrometry. These silicon detectors are used. Yeah. an edge resolution that is working in the range of kVs up to MeVs. Yeah. And okay, this energy resolution is somewhere between 1 kV. And for lower energies, we need to have very thin window. Yeah, this is important from this point of view because you have this ionization, and if energy is smaller, that will be energy losses for electrons which are going through this some window and some envelope which is around this sensitive volume of the semiconductor detectors. Yeah. Okay, these semiconductor detectors are sensitive also to gamma radiation. Yeah. That we discussed this detection of gamma and gamma radiation detection in the last time, and it's from this it's clear that the semiconductor detectors are sensitive to gamma. That means if we have field in which we have gamma and electrons, it is difficult to distinguish these electrons and gammas. In this case, it's possible to use magnetic transporter. You know that this magnetic field will not change magnitude of momenta. It will change only direction of movement, but magnitude of momenta and energy will be not changed by magnetic field. That means it is possible to transport this electron using magnetic field to another place. And this place, because photons are moving only in the prime line, that means in one direction, it's possible, and it is possible also to shield some place from this gamma radiation, and to this place we will transport this biomagnetic field, these electrons to this place after shielding, and okay, and it is possible to measure in this place only detectors by this semiconductor, only electrons by this semiconductor detectors. This semiconductor detectors is possible to do also as position sensitive detectors. In this case, we have some silicon wafer with thickness about 300 micrometers, and we will put on it very thin 1 micrometer aluminum strips, yeah, which are working as electrodes. Yeah. And okay, that means we will have these strips as electrodes, and okay, that's we will use information about ionization near to some electrode, and it will be possible to obtain information about position of interaction of this particle with this detector. This is possible to use these strips. It is also possible to use small modular single cells. And for the strip, we have silicon strip detectors for these detectors which have different electrodes as module. It will be silicon pixel detectors. They have the best resolution, position resolution. And second possibility is that we have electrodes only in one direction, set of electrodes. And okay, this is only on the boundary of this detector. And this produced electrons, electron vacancy, electron hole pairs, these electrons are transported to these electrodes. And in this case, we will obtain this second coordinate. One coordinate is given by information which electrode was firing. Second coordinate is given by this drift time. Yeah. And this type of detectors are named as silicon drift detectors. Here is some example of silicon drift detectors which were made by Czech Republic for this ALICE experiment, which is in the sand. Okay, now we are going to electrostatic and magnetic spectrometers. You know how particles are moving, and charged particles are moving in electric and magnetic field. Okay, this Lorentz force, which is forced in electric field, this acting force is here. It is linearly dependent on charge, and it is also linearly dependent on intensity of electric field, and it is in the same direction as this intensity of electric field. If you have magnetic field, this acting force, this Lorentz force, this part, magnetic part of this Lorentz force, is that, again, it is linearly dependent on the charge, and also it is dependent on vector multiplying of velocity and intensity of magnetic field. Yeah? If this intensity of magnetic field is perpendicular to velocity, in this case, this vector multiplying will be scalar multiplying, and we will obtain this. And okay, if we will look that this is also this centrifugal force, and we see centrifugal force is given by this Lorentz force, and okay, we have this equation. Okay, here is V square and here is V. That means it's possible to sketch, and you have here momenta M times V. Momenta M times V is E times B times R. Okay, that means momenta is given by MV, and it is given also as charge times intensity of magnetic field and radius of this movement of this particle. But it's necessary to say that it is only in the case in which you have perpendicular intensity of magnetic field and velocity. Okay, fine. From this, it's possible to see how looks like this relative uncertainty of determination of this momenta. Yeah? In this case, we will obtain momenta. That means this uncertainty of momenta is given by uncertainty of determination of intensity of magnetic field and this radiuses. Okay, that's in the case of non-relativistic approximation, if will be not relativistic movement. In this case, this mass is constant. If will be relativistic particle, this velocity will be high enough, for example, more than 14% of velocity of the light, it's necessary to include this correction of change of mass. That means it's necessary to use this relativistic mass of electrons. Okay, this resolution of this magnetic spectrometer is given by momenta resolution, because in this we measure this radiuses, and we will obtain this information about momenta. That means, okay, this relative resolution is given, is resolution of momenta, and it is given by these parameters. Okay. If we will look on electrostatic field here, in this case, this resolution is given by energy. And we will obtain energy resolution. And again, in this case, if you will have, for example, monoenergetic source of electrons, we will see some Gaussian, and this uncertainty is possible to obtain as full width in half maximum of this energy Gaussian peaks. The same here. Here, because you have information, you will measure these radiuses, and you will obtain uncertainty of these radiuses. And again, you will see how it looks like if will be monoenergetic or monomomenta electron beam or electron intensity. That means it's possible to obtain from this full width in half maximum. Okay, that now will be interesting also to look, because from momenta we sometimes need to calculate kinetic energy of this electron. That means for us it's also interesting to have a relation between kinetic energy and this parameter BR, which we will measure and we will use in magnetic spectrometers. Okay, we know that kinetic energy is difference between total energy and rest energy of electron. We know how it looks like relation between relativistic momenta, relativistic mass and rest mass of electron, and also how it looks like relation between total energy and rest energy. Because if we will hit this, we will multiply by C square, we will obtain total energy, and if this we will multiply by C square, we will obtain rest energy of electron. That means from this it's possible to obtain, again, this is only this relation, we put it this here, that means it is here, and we made already square of this. That here will be total energy times this Lorentz factor, and okay, here or square of this inverse of Lorentz factor, and here will be rest energy, square of rest. This is this factor, square of this factor, and here is rest energy. Now we will make a multiplying by C square, and also we will multiply these parts of this this bracket, which is inside this brackets, and we will obtain here m square c four. Here, this is some mistake. It should be here c square. And okay, that in this case it's possible to check and made this m square v square by this EBR here, EBR here. That means on the end we will obtain this EBR square. Okay, that in this case again it's possible to use this total energy as rest energy and kinetic energy, and this kinetic energy is this total energy is square root of rest energy plus momenta square and c square. That means on the end we will obtain from this equation kinetic energy, that here this rest energy will go here, And okay, that will be NP. We will give this rest energy from these brackets. Here will be it is rest energy square. That means it will be possible to make square root, and we will obtain rest energy. And here will be this E square and BR square, and divided by rest energy square. And minus one, because okay, this was rest energy and divided by rest energy, because here we have this rest energy outside of this bracket. Okay, now what is also interesting for us, it's determination of relation between momenta and energy resolution. Maybe it will be fine if you will look on it and you will derive this on the paper. It is the best, because normally if it is not online but contact lecturing, it is the best to show on the table. But what is important, we will obtain relation between uncertainty in energy, kinetic energy, and uncertainty in the momenta. And as I said, if you have this magnetic spectrometer, your resolution is given by resolution of the momenta, because by this BR you are measuring this momenta. In the for the electrostatic spectrometer, you are measuring kinetic energy, which is depending on kinetic energy, and you have resolution of kinetic energy. If you want to obtain which will be resolution of kinetic energy or uncertainty of determination of kinetic energy, in the case if you are measured this resolution of momenta, that means it's necessary to use this this factor. That means this wanted relation between resolution for determination of kinetic energy and the determination of momenta, or this BR, it is given by this formula. If you are will look on this, how it looks like with dependency on kinetic energy, here for very low energies, if you see, this will be in non-relativistic case. That means it will be very small kinetic energy. Velocity is much smaller than velocity of the light. Kinetic energy is much smaller than rest energy. In this case, if you will look here, that means that this rest energy is much higher than kinetic energy. That means here it's possible to neglect this kinetic energy against this rest energy. Here will be rest energy, here will be rest energy, and here will be two. This is this. Here is relation between uncertainty or resolution of kinetic energy determination and this determination of momenta, that means uncertainty or resolution of determination of momenta, will be two. If you will increase this energy to very high values, and it's clear, and it is also possible to see that for this non-relativistic case, this two you will obtain on also from non-relativistic equation. If you have non-relativistic equation, kinetic energy is depending on square of momenta divided by two times rest mass. If you will make derivation of this, it will be this p square, it will be two times p, times dp. Here will be two times ME, and you will obtain relation between differential of kinetic energy and differential of momenta here. If you will make ratio between differential of kinetic energy and kinetic energy, it's possible to put this here. Yeah, it will be P divided by M dP. You will put this kinetic energy, and also on the end you will obtain this 2 times dP divided by P. Yeah? That means, okay, you will obtain for non-relativistic case using non-relativistic equation, relation between kinetic energy and momenta, and you will obtain this relation between these two uncertainties. If you will have case in which this kinetic energy is very high, that means this is ultra-relativistic case. In this case, this kinetic energy, which will be much higher than this rest energy, that means rest energy will be negligible, and here this will be very, very small against this kinetic energy, that means this part will be zero and you will obtain this one. Yeah, that means this is non-relativistic case, this is relativistic case, that means it's necessary to use this relativistic relations between momenta and kinetic energy, and here you will have this ultra-relativistic case. And the same, this one, you will obtain for this ultra-relativistic case, because for this case, kinetic energy is total energy, this rest energy is negligible, and from this relation which you have between total energy is rest energy, total energy square is rest energy square plus P square C square, you will obtain this rest energy is possible to neglect against this total energy and P square C square, and you will obtain that from this relativistic equation, that from this relativistic relation, that total energy is on the end equal this P times C. That means it is linear dependency between kinetic energy and total energy, and from this you will obtain this relation between these uncertainties. That means, again, if you will use this ultra-relativistic relation between kinetic energy and momenta, you will obtain a proper relation between these uncertainties. Yeah? Okay. Which are these basic characteristics of these electron spectrometers? We have, as I said, that depends now, this is for some classical spectrometers, which are for these lower energies. Yeah? In this case, there are four ranges between about electron volts, 10 electron volts, up to thousands kVs. Yeah. This resolution is there are values which are for different type of spectrometers. This is not one spectrometer, and there are different types of spectrometer. That means second possibility is this resolution. That means or this energy or momenta resolution. Okay, what is also important, this is solid angle to which these detected electrons are emitted. That means this is acceptance. Yeah, how many electrons are running to detector and how many electrons we lose. Again, these values here, they are not for one detector, that there are different types of detectors. Some of them are mostly for to obtain high acceptance, for some low acceptance. This high acceptance, it is about 20, it is possible to obtain up to 20%. there are also what is important for some type of such spectrometers is sizes of source which is possible to put to spectrometer and which is possible to measure. There are some types of spectrometers which have very small possible size of target, about half of square millimeters, but there are some another spectrometer which are working also with very high samples and about hundreds square cube square centimeter. That very important quantity is transmission. That means that show you how big part of monoenergetic electron beam will reach detector, because we will lose some part of this electron beam is lost. Total luminosity is the multiplying of this transition and size of detector. And electron optical quality is ratio between this transmission and this resolution. Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, fine. Already we were talking about electron optical quality, which is ratio between transition and resolution, or luminosity and resolution. That means it is possible to see that if transition is larger and resolution is smaller, that means its resolution is higher, but the value is smaller, you will obtain better electron optical quality. The same is with this luminosity. And if luminosity is increasing, that's fine. It's better spectrometer if the total luminosity are higher. If resolution is better, that means that this value of this R is smaller. Yeah, that means this spectrometer is better. Okay, we are talking about magnetic electron spectrometers. That means it is also important to know which magnetic fields are used. And there are four. That means it depends really which energy of electrons are measured. Yeah. If there are these energies are small, it is enough to have small magnetic fields. If you have high energy electrons, for example, near to tens of hundreds MeVs, you need to have higher intensity of magnetic field, that, and up to 3 Tesla. But we will discuss also this high energy dielectron spectrometer or dielectron spectrometer, and in this case this intensity of magnetic field is really near to this 3 Tesla, and it is necessary to do superconducting magnets. Okay. It is also very important preparation of this source, because if you have a source in which these electrons will lose some energy, you will obtain not so accurate data. This was about magnetic spectrometer, and as I said, in this case we are measuring this momentas, and you will obtain also this uncertainty is given by this resolution of momenta resolution. Here we look on electrostatic spectrometers. It is possible to use these spectrometers only up to about 50 kV, yeah, because we need to have this high voltage, yeah. And if it is 50 kV, electron charge of electron is one electron charge, and you know that from definition of this electron volt, it's clear that for a stopping of 50 kV, you need to have 50,000 volts voltage. That means it is very, very high. Yeah. In electrostatic spectrometers, also magnetic fields are used. Yeah. They are used for focusing of these electrons to measuring place. And also they are using a slits, which makes possible selection of momenta. That means it is possible to select some part of this spectra. Okay, this electric field will produce potential barrier, which transmits only electrons which energy is higher than given threshold. That means two detector will go only these electrons which have energy which is higher than given threshold. In this case, it's possible to use two types of measurements. One is integral method of measurements, that during every measurement, it's for given decelerating. And all spectra, all electrons which have higher energy are measured. And you will change this, that means still intensity will be lower, lower, lower. And on the end, this integral one channel measurement, you will recalculate, and you will calculate differences between neighboring channels. Differential method of measurements, it will use also motion in magnetic field, and this energy range which is measured is defined, and it is not so wide. Problem is that in both cases you have a single channel measurement, and this is from this reason it is very, very big importance of time stability of this voltage. Yeah. And that means it's necessary to have this stability and also calibration. It's clear that on the end of the spectrometer, you need to have a detector, which will measure that you have electron. Yeah. There are, in many cases, channeltrons are used. They are very suitable for this low energies up to these kVs. Mostly, it's possible to use a microchannel plate, and you have also such position sensitivity, which is better for better resolution. Second possibility, there are detectors which are based on this semiconductor detector, and there are silicon detectors. It's possible to measure also position sensitive detectors, to use position sensitive detectors. Mostly this drift or pixel detectors. Here you have this magnetic spectrometer, and in this case, this magnetic field is used for determination of this electron momenta. And okay, you have relation between this momenta and kinetic energy of this electron. In this case, this resolution is very near for 0.1% or something like that, 1%. There are many types which were used during history of spectrometry of electrons. There are plane spectrometers, which field has plane symmetry, lens spectrometer. Today, in experiments, which are, for example, for measurement of this conversion electrons, this orange or mini orange type of spectrometers are used. In this case, you have here magnets, which are split into sectors, mostly six sectors are here. You see six sectors. And in reality, here you have this beam of electrons, and okay, here is detectors, and it's possible from movement from this path throws this magnetic field, it's possible to obtain information about energy. This transmission, one problem is that this transmission throws this system is relatively small, and it is depending on energy. That means it's necessary to have some nice calibration of efficiency of these detectors, and which is given by this transmission. It's possible to use this magnetic field also in the case of magnetic transporter, which will transport your electrons to some place which will be outside, for example, gamma field, and in this place you will have this silicon detector, and we will measure energy of electron by this silicon detectors. Okay, that in this case it's possible to use toroidal magnetic field, that in this case you have motion on cycloid, and okay, that in this case it's possible to transport this electron to another place, and what is important, that this movement in magnetic field will not change your momenta, magnitude of momenta, that means also energy of electron. This is very important to know, this transmission of transport system, yeah, because this will give you efficiency of such system, and efficiency, and also after that, this efficiency of transporting system times efficiency of this detector will give you efficiency of all your spectrometer. Okay, that some of these spectrometers, this orange and mini orange, also use this transporter, because in this case you need also to put outside this detector outside of this gamma field. Magnetic spectrometer for very high energies are named as Dilepton spectrometer. Yeah. By this spectrometer is possible to measure energies of electron, positrons, muons, and antimuons. Yeah. There are many particle decays which are in which these pairs of lepton and antilepton are produced, and with very high energy. This composition of such spectrometer, it is necessary to obtain information about momenta by changing of path of the detector, of direction of movement of particle during path throughs magnetic field. That means, and because we have high energy electron, high energy muon, it's necessary to have very intensive magnet. Often it is superconductive magnet. And we need to have some position sensitive detectors before magnet and after magnet. Yeah. And okay, that there are also in very often also they used this some another detectors which discriminating different particles, and will discriminate, for example, hadrons, which are particles, for example, protons, mesons, which are particle which interact by strong interaction, and this light electrons, yeah, which are not interacting by this strong interaction. And also from time of flight it's possible to obtain if you have light particle which have velocity which is very near to velocity of the light. Here is an example of this muon spectrometer. For muon, it's also very special feature of muon is that they have a very, very small cross sections of interaction during movement through material. That means if you have here such shielding, it will be possible to absorb all hadrons and other particles, and only muons will go through this shielding. Yeah, this is reason why this spectrometer NA50, which is working in CERN, has this shielding. After that, here there are this multi-wire proportional chamber. There are, in reality, you have this is seven planes of this multi-wire channel, multi-wire chamber, proportional chamber. That means there are these gas detectors, and it's possible to obtain precise information about direction of movement of this lepton, of this muon in this case. Here you have this magnetic field produced by superconductive magnet, and they will change direction of movement, and after that you have again multi-wire proportional chamber, and in this case there are five of this, and after that you will have some detectors which distinguish between these hadrons and muons. Okay, this is some example of the lepton spectrometer. Last example that I have is Cherenkov radiation detector. Here is example of one of this type of this detector which was used in experiment series. If you know this Cherenkov detectors, in this case it's necessary to use some mirror which this Cherenkov radiation will mirroring to some system of CCD chambers to detect of this light and to see Cherenkov rings which are produced by movement of this particles which are moving if in some gas with velocity which is higher than velocity of the light in this gas, mostly because you need to distinguish between very near velocities. This is your particles has velocity which is very near to velocity of the light in the vacuum. It is necessary to have not solid material or not also liquid because index of refraction of liquid is much higher than in this gas, and you need to have a smaller index of refraction. Yeah, and here is some examples of such systems which are used in experiment hardest and experiment series. One is in Germany and second is in CERN in